here from Haken, about to jump on a call with the one and only Jim Grey from Caligula's Horse. Let's admit him into the chat room now. Here we go. Oh, it's beer o'clock already?
It is. I mean, it's perfectly reasonable. It's 7 p.m. on a Friday night. I refuse to be judged. How are you, man?
Good stuff. Yeah, I'm great. And I'm so pleased that the connection's good, because, you know, the usual bugbears with delays, and you couldn't be further away from me if you tried. So this is cool.
I love this background right now. How big is your Pixar collection in general?
I'm joined by Mike, Sully and Nemo, of course, the Australian reference.
Oh, that's good. I'm glad.
There's not many more, actually. I have Buzz and Woody up there, and Wally as well, alongside Ziltoid and some Star Wars figurines. Oh, plus a handcrafted wooden sculpture of Haken as well.
Really?
Yeah, one of many.
Is that just for you, or is that something I can get my hands on?
No, that was one of many fabulous gifts that we've received from fans over the years.
That's awesome.
Which is always nice.
That's so sick.
How are you, my friend?
Yeah, I wish we got stuff like that. Oh, you know. Okay. Actually, it's funny. The Aussie bloke inside me wants to go, yeah, no. We're all good. Everything's fine. It's not. It's not fine.
It's really not.
It's really not fine. I feel adrift. I'm glad you asked. The wind has been taken out of my sails. How are you in all of this? Because it's sort of more fucked up over where you are right now.
Pretty much. And, you know, it's gotten quite political here, to be honest, in the UK. more than anything. We're very conflicted about, as a nation, what the correct protocol is with things like masks and going back to schools and whatnot. So,
yeah, that's sort of infecting the world a bit, isn't it? I mean, like,
I often try and avoid religion and politics when it comes to music stuff, but it's hard not to, right? I mean, it's such a prominent issue.
Certainly right now.
Yeah, I mean,
it's my biggest bugbear.
Yeah, I mean, for the first time, really, like, I found myself including some of the stuff into lyrics, and it's something I normally steer clear from. I'm normally in the fantasy world when it comes to lyric writing, but
that makes sense.
We started, like, you know, drawing parallels.
The same thing, but like, you know, I'm a loudmouth.
I don't believe it for a second.
Like when it comes to the. No, why would anyone say such an awful thing about me? No, it's the same. I mean, it's like, you know, I used to run my mouth a lot earlier in our career with, like, politics and whatever. And I kind of mellowed out, you know. I was kind of like, yeah, maybe, you know, people don't really want to hear what I have to say. Like, let's just make people feel happy and leave it at that. And now here we are. And I honestly can't help myself anymore. So I don't know. Maybe the next album is going to be just pure... just Rage Against the Machine. That's the next step for us. It's simple as that. Riffs and me yelling. That's all.
Yeah, I mean, you can't go wrong with that, really.
Honestly, no. And someone's got to do it. what's the last I'm looking at my watch. Like, I know what month it is. What's the last couple of months been like for you guys? And the album coming and having to not do shit with it.
Yeah, I mean, to backtrack a little bit, when everything kicked off, we were on the road with Devin, touring in the US.
True.
And we were halfway through the tour, actually, and we had a day off in Nashville. And I mean, on the periphery, we could see things were unraveling, but we didn't really know to what extent. And then suddenly, like, overnight, it was, you know, this city's shutting down. We're just pulling the tour, you know. And in fact, we weren't even told initially. We were in the car park of a supermarket chain, and which I won't mention for legal reasons. And we, yeah, we just, we heard from our driver in the morning. Yeah, the other band have just flown home to Canada. They've gone.
Fuck.
And so we didn't, we thought it was a joke, like a prank was being pulled on us. What?
Yeah, true.
Suddenly, you know, before we knew it, we were flapping our arms around, like trying to find emergency flights to go home. And it was crazy. And we got hit financially big time from that.
Oh, God.
So obviously we... On a support tour, it's unlikely that you make much money anyway, as you know. Like it's really about promotion, and you're lucky if you break even and those kind of things. So yeah, that hit us hard. And
see, that's the nightmare, isn't it?
Big time.
I can't, like, because we were looking at the US tour on the release of Rise Radiant, and the thought that was going through our minds is how close we dodged that bullet, like exactly that situation where, you know, when it's beforehand, there's not all the tour bus costs. There's not all of that stuff that we had to face that, you know, we weren't in that yet. We, like, the only thing that we had was flights and visas, and that was basically it.
Yeah.
And of course that's not nothing, but it didn't bankrupt us and send us all packing back to our regular lives. But yeah, so I can imagine, man, that would have been sheer brutality.
Yeah. We got home, all, you know, kind of jet lagged and full of depression, and it was pretty mental. But I mean, the positive thing was we had this album in the can, and it was all on track in a way. And we were lucky enough also to have planned a video shoot while we were out in the States, so we at least had one kind of video in the bag. Subsequent videos have been animations, because literally we haven't been able to get together. So.
Was there ever a point during all of that where you've gone about that album title, you know, was that, because I know it was planned well and truly in advance, and of course it's following on from Vector and all of that, but like, surely that would have been a point of like, fuck, why me, you know?
Jim, you know, this is turning into like every press interview I've had so far on this album.
I'm sorry. Let me
no it's cool.
Let me curse some more. I'll drink more beer.
Yeah, that, I mean, that the title is unbelievably coincidental. Like you're probably aware, obviously it's a follow on from Vector, a previous record, and the Vector virus concept was
totally,
was, you know, preordained, pre-planned like a couple of years ago. So yeah,
it's so bizarre, the
irony was not lost on us at all. Yeah.
Not at all. I mean, like we had, it was really interesting, like almost in the opposite direction, because this is even before COVID and all that shit. Like we were, it was during the bushfires that we were recording Rise Radiant in Australia, because that was quite extensive.
Yeah.
Because let's not forget how fucked up everything's been. We'd chosen the covers that we were going to do, like the bonus tracks and stuff, and we did Don't Give Up by Peter Gabriel, and we chose that well and truly in advance. And then when it came to recording it, like I'm in the studio and there's a line in that was... it drove the night towards my home, the place where I was born by the lakeside. And it's something that leads into the trees have burned down to the ground. And as I'm recording, I'm just like, holy, oh, like man. The amount of coincidence that happened with this album was just like shuddery and spooky for sure.
Shivers, man. Seriously. Yeah. I mean, similarly, like a lot of the lyrics in Virus were about, they were metaphors, but they were about isolation and it was just absolutely crazy how, you know, I mean, now it's released, people are listening to it literally in isolation going, what? How did they foresee this? What's this?
Do this?
It's just the best promotional.
We tour. Did this. This is our fault.
And, yeah.
Oh, it feels so terrible to say that. It really does. Yeah, holy shit.
It's crazy. But yeah, I mean, the truth is we're at the kind of 11th hour and the label were like, you know, there's no right or wrong here, but if you want to change the title, you can't. It's a little bit too late, but you know, it's something we can facilitate, and we didn't want to throw away that kind of artistic integrity that we've been working up to all this time, all this record. And
that's
true. By calling it Vector 2, wouldn't have had the same ring. No, definitely not.
Vector bracket as well.
As well.
You know, it's whenever I see shit like that, it's like anyone that like knows your music or is a fan would like there'd be no question that you, of the fact that it was part of an artistic statement rather than a like, hey, let's fucking cash in, let's get it done, you know. Oh my god. But we had a similar kind of shit fight, obviously, in the lead up. Like, it was really, you know, fucking upsetting. And it's so lame because like none of us, like, I don't even know going into this whether you guys have it all, but like, you know, none of us have lost family or close friends, and none of us have been sick. You know, we're in relatively safe areas. We've gotten out really well through this whole thing, and we're not even in Queensland. We're not even in the same lockdown as like Victoria, because those guys, it sucks for them right now. And I still feel bad for, like, I'm whinging by saying that I'm really still in a shitty place after all of this, you know, like sitting at home, putting on weight for 3 or 4 months. Like, that's basically my life right now. You know? So, you know, I'm working on my belly though. It's nice. It's like, if you hit it now, it makes like a little, it's got a little sound to it, which is quite, you know, pleasant.
Yeah, we've got a sample of that.
Good, you can use that in the next album, that'd be great.
I've got to say though, man,
anytime you're doing like tacit hits,
your record, you know, it got me through a lot of this lockdown.
Really?
Yeah, I mean, I just on a very basic level, I mean, I was using it for my daily workouts. I was going on a run every day. I live near the beach. Have this nice route.
Like, oh, great.
Which I can take. And,
yeah, I've seen some Instagram stuff that you've tried.
Yeah, get some exercise. And it's running something I've always kind of hated, but like the Haken guys were going out on regular runs during the tour, and I was really lagging behind. So I was like, I've got to up my game here. get some training in.
And you can't be that guy.
No. And this was the perfect opportunity, really. And obviously, your album came out like, at the end of May, was it? I guess.
Sure, you tell me. I think, yeah.
And the singles before that, obviously. So, yeah, that was a daily listen for me. I mean, there were some pretty pumped tracks on there that were helping me through, like push those extra miles, you know.
So it's very nice to hear.
Yeah, it's definitely one of my favorite records of yours to date.
That's sick. Yeah. Thank you. And it's going to sound disingenuous now in return, because you've said that and now I'm saying this. But I have to say, straight up, I think Virus is overall my favorite Haken album, taking into account that The Mountain for me has all of this nostalgic stuff attached to it, like, you know, the moments in time, you're like, do I love this more because of this? But I honestly have to say Canary Yellow just fucking floored me, like, purely because like my entire thing is like emotion and like, you know, everything sort of gilded with kind of making people feel frisson or something overwhelming and expressing that. And honestly, the chorus of that, just like that last line, the till death do us part, I think is the lyric there. It's just like, that's the moment. That's where all the goosies hit and you go like, fuck. So yeah, that's mine. That's me. You can sample that clap as well.
Yeah. I mean, there's definitely parallels with The Mountain actually, which is probably why this record might be resonating with some people.
Like,
which is really cool, because The Mountain dealt with a lot of personal and, you know, human hard truths and struggles and things like that. So there was a very definite message with that record which resonated with a lot of people. And by the way, I'm going to drop in Caligula's Horse song titles where I can in this conversation. And just
I hadn't even noticed, and I wrote the shit, I don't know.
Hey,
we could drop Marigold, and that would be both of us.
Yeah, man,
right,
double hit.
Where do you get the audacity to steal ideas from us? Who do you think you are? Is the next question.
Who do you think you are? Yeah, brilliant. I think we stole it from Periphery, actually.
Yeah, no, true. So it's a hand me down because they stole it from us. And the thing is, when it happened with Periphery, fair enough. But then with you guys, it was just like, why do you hate us when we've shown you nothing but love? I'm going to crack this now. It's going to be a really satisfying sound. I'm going to do this near the mic.
Is that beer number two? I'm getting jealous.
It is beer number two. These are actually made around the corner from my house in this little sort of family-run brewery. And it's here's some sound for you.
Very nice. Yeah, I mean,
ASMR.
I hate to break this to you, but I kind of stopped drinking during the last couple of months as well.
Well done, you.
I have been drinking non-alcoholic beer. So I feel like I'm kind of cheating.
What's the best non-alcoholic beer?
Quite enjoyed the Erdinger. It's like a, I think it's German.
I've had that one.
Really has a nice taste to it. So
yeah, I did a stint of non-drinking about 6-7 months in 2018, I think, in the lead up to a tour for, you know, vocal reasons.
Yeah.
I found some that was like dishwater gross and some that tasted like shitty Australian beer, and that was fine. And then there were a couple of the German ones. It was like a wheat beer. I think that is the Erdinger, which was like, as good as
it
gets.
Yeah, really nice. Yeah, I mean, I don't miss it. I wasn't really ever getting drinking to get drunk, really. But mm-hmm. Yeah, that's that.
That's all I've got. That's all I've got, Russ. this is, if you want to look at what rock bottom looks like, screen cap this. This is where we are. I'll be huffing paint next. You'll find me eating out of a bin. Oh, this is the squeakiest chair in the world.
Jim, have you become like a school teacher during this lockdown period? You have kids?
I actually did. I did for a while. Yeah, I was teaching my daughter. And fortunately for me, she's in prep. Right. Which is like preschool here, which means that it was like alphabet and stuff and not trigonometry, which is a real benefit, because otherwise I would have been a detriment to her education. But no, it's been good. I actually have another daughter on the way right now.
Oh man, congratulations. That's amazing.
Thank you. It took literally seconds of effort on my part to make that happen. So, But no, it's I'm really excited about that. That's one of the things that's sort of keeping us going forward right now. So,
oh mate, that's fantastic news.
Yeah,
awesome stuff. That must be really exciting.
Schools are back. Schools are back now, so it's all good.
So you're a free man, kind of.
I am a free man.
Yeah.
And now I'm trying to find meaning in beer.
Have you guys been able to hook up? I mean, I saw like you were able to do a video together, weren't you? Like, quite early on in the
That was like the first time we'd seen each other in months, I think.
Yeah.
And it was really nice. We did, but like it's all socially distanced sort of music video kind of thing. It was all very strange. We want to do some live stuff as well. Like, I'm sure you guys have things in the works. Wait, you guys did do like a live thing, right? Have you guys done a live?
We've
like video at all?
We've mostly been doing, I hadn't even heard of Twitch before this lockdown, by the way, but we jumped on the Twitch streaming channel and we've been doing various, like Q&A and quiz nights, and things like that. Did we have a break? I think I had a lapse in the communication there, but I hope you heard me.
I got it from context. I had a couple of little bits. Yeah.
So
it's funny, Twitch I'm aware of because I'm a bit of a gamer, so I'm excited that you guys are doing that.
Cool. Yeah, well that's the thing, like I'm not a gamer, so I hadn't heard of Twitch. It took me a while to figure out what it all meant and whatever the coins and rupees you get and hype trains, and I still don't know anything about it, but
just let the chat deal with it. That's not your stuff. That's exactly. They'll take care of the lingo.
I mean that's been kind of fun on the side, definitely. In terms of music, like it kind of all shut down I've been busy promoting the record with interviews, and we've been doing the making sure the music videos came out and stuff like that. But other than that, like I mean, the reason I bring up the kids question was, you know, Charlie and Rich have kids and they immediately were just like, man, we've become high school, primary school teachers now, and all their time was just gone with that. We had a couple of guys moving house, we had Diego stuck in the US and without any of his gear and like without communication, so it was just
oh my god, of course,
it was just like what sort a nightmare. Just died on its feet. On the surface, like things were happening, the album was coming out, videos were coming out, we were doing press, there was interviews, but we were trying to keep up with those quiz nights and things on the side, but yeah,
it's such a bizarre feeling to have that. It's so strange, like when you've got all the momentum of an album release. And like, we've been there a lot of times, both of us, and you know, like, but you feel that ramp up and it's like, boom, here we go. And now we're going to make some memories with this music. We're going to share it with people. And it's not just the lack of touring that's very strange. It's just that it feels like it kind of, and just disappears. You know what I mean? It's for all of this momentum, It feels all of a sudden like you're just in sludge and it just goes out from underneath you. It's a very, very strange sensation.
Do you think the album
really good to say before and it's gone?
You think the album suffered though from this, or like the sales wise? Are you thinking?
Initially, us, luckily. I mean, I don't know about you guys. Like, you guys had even delays and you charted really well.
Yeah.
This time around, which is awesome.
Yeah, I mean, I guess at this time, people need music more than ever, even if it's not live, you know.
Oh my God, yes.
I mean, it really sucks that we can't go out and see shows or do shows.
Yes, please. Yeah. That's like, it's the one thing that I'm good at. It's the
one job, man.
Christ. You know, I'm not very useful to society on the whole. It's like the truth that I'm, and so this whole thing that's, you know, just the one piece that's missing in my life is just everyone's like, man, I miss live shows, and I'm like, man, I miss meaning anything at all to anyone outside of this house. Yeah, so cheers.
Yeah, amen to that.
Oh, things are escalating.
I'll cheers you with my water. There we go.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, I mean, Inside Out have been great for all this kind of
totally
giving us ideas to keep things ticking along, and I mean, it's all good.
Actually, it's funny, that's what I was going to say before, the like the weird thing, because obviously you guys are in the position that we are, where, you know, we're not in a position to be able to create new stuff really, and further to that, I'm feeling massively uninspired and kind of like down and terrible about all of this, and yet that
Please don't tell me.
I was just like, now's the time for, I can't wait to hear all the music that's going to come out of our creatives and all of our musicians. Oh no. Am I back?
Oh yeah, you're back. It's all good.
I'm going to keep moving my house. Yes.
That was a lag.
So how much of my bullshit did you hear before?
No, I think I got it. It caught up with itself, and you're probably got like a couple of second delay, but it's all good.
Ah, cool. Yeah, that's fine. I mean, we're really very far away and we're talking with tin cans and a piece of string.
There you go.
I mean, I hate it when people say that. Like, it actually has made me, I try to let that kind of stuff wash over people. That's just what people are saying. But it got under my skin when people are talking about, you know, like, oh, you know, musicians are going to have this is the best for them. You know, they got all this time at home. They're going to be creative. I can't wait to hear the music that comes out of this. And I'm like, well, here's a big old fuck you to that, because I you know, I'm as stuck as you are and I'm as down as you are.
Yeah.
And I've got nothing to say right now, which is so unfortunate, because that's, you know, that's what I want. I want to be able to do that. But I think for a lot of us, it's kind of, that's where we're at, you know, depressing.
Yeah.
This is a very uplifting chat for everyone.
Well, this is, I don't know where to share this, but I probably should. It might make you cry, but I mean, it was probably at the end of April, early May, but I mean, I was really hit hard by this, and I was having some issues at home, like a relationship, and obviously I wasn't bringing money in, and things were really bad for me, and this with some other issues going on as well, and I was in a fucking dark place, and I put an Instagram post out, and it was just a photo of myself. And I was probably at my lowest I've ever been in my life. And two people reached out to me. A good friend, actually one of the original Haken members, Matt Marshall, who lives in Sydney, and yourself, both sent me personal messages saying, are you all right, dude?
I remember this now, yeah.
And it was really like, I really appreciated that, man. And it was so bizarre to me that the two people that reached out couldn't have been further away, Sydney and Brisbane, it really wasn't an explicit cry for help or anything. I was literally I don't even know why I took the photo, but yeah, I just put some kind of reference to a Haken lyric and a kind of message to say, hang in there, everyone. This is a shit time, but you know, let's get through this together. And, you know, the cliche kind of message.
Yeah.
But yeah, man, like out of everybody in the world, yes, like,
totally.
You reached out, you know, you checked on me, man. I thought that was beautiful. So yeah, I just want to say thank you, because on the back of that, I kind of got off my ass and sorted my life out a little bit. And yeah, kind of found some focus. And you were saying, I'm going to contradict what you said earlier about kind of musicians being inspired and stuff, because at that point I was like you a little bit, I really wasn't. Everything was shit. And yeah, I found a little drive to kind of write some music for myself and pick up the guitar and reconnect with that, because originally I was a guitarist, not a singer, you know, predominantly.
Right.
And I kind of put the guitar down for 10 years or so, and you know, left that to Rich and Charlie to handle in Haken.
Got caught up in this other little thing, you know?
Yeah. So like, I'm obviously really pleased where I am now as a vocalist, but yeah, that gave me the inspiration to kind of, you know, give me some purpose and reconnect with something. And so yeah, I just want to say thank you, man. That was a beautiful thing you did, reaching out to me.
Yeah, no worries, man. I'm really glad to hear that you're doing much better now. That's
I'm doing awesome. Great. Yeah, doing great.
Well, I feel like, you know, when it's, because obviously, like, I've been through some stupid level mental health shit throughout the past. It's an ongoing thing for me. I just think it's, you know, whenever I see stuff like that, like, I fully recognize and relate to exactly what's going on. It's like other people might see, you know, it's sadness or whatever, and I'm just like, no, I have been in that moment. I know exactly what that feels like.
Yeah.
So yeah, no, of course, man. Always ready for a chat if you need it.
Yeah, beautiful. Yeah, it's something I don't normally get into those kind of states of mind. So it was a rare thing, but yeah. Anyway, like the last, you asked, back to your original question about an hour ago, what I've been doing for the last couple of months is I have been putting together some songs for myself, because yeah, like you said, Haken shut down. So yeah, I've actually decided that I might use that photograph as an album cover for a solo project or something, because it was like songs kind of born out of that time. We'll see. Yeah.
So what's the kind of style? Like, what's the, if you don't have to give it away if you're not giving little snippets out yet, but like, what's the thing you're doing with it?
Yeah, I mean, this, I'm kind of, you're one of the first people to know. and nice. and subsequently probably the world now that we're sharing this. Yeah. But everyone's expecting me to write a country album, because I have like a very soft spot for Nashville country music. But it ain't going to be that.
Are there hats? Do you wear hats? Damn it. That's a shame.
I do wear hats, yeah.
I'll have to get you a hat. I'll get you a really special hat.
I need one of those Australian ones with the corks hanging. That's what I need.
Oh, like a proper Akubra. Yeah, that's disgusting. Yeah, absolutely. when you come through again, you'll definitely have to get one.
I mean, needless to say, they're probably borderline offensive nowadays, but... Mexican sombreros and
yeah, you can't get away with that. That's not 2020 business.
No, nope.
I reckon the cork hat you could probably get away with, if I'm being honest.
Still a thing.
I don't think we care so much. Yeah, well, it was never a thing, and I think that's why it's okay.
Yeah, I mean,
but I look forward to hearing that, man. I'm excited.
Yeah, we'll see. It's coming along.
Maybe I should do the same. I'll do my release, and I'll release it before yours, so I can just lower the expectation.
Well, we had this thing,
all
like,
stuff is going to happen. You can come in and just look it.
We had this thing in the 90s of the Britpop era of Oasis and Blur, and they had this campaign where they released singles on the same day, and it was a kind of competitive nature to it, who would get to the number one spot. And I think it helped both bands massively by doing that.
Was that like the 90s rock equivalent of like beef in the rap game? You know, like rappers starting beef and shit with each other, except it's, you know, Oasis and Blur.
Yeah, basically.
I wouldn't fuck with Oasis.
Less guns and less, you know, attitude, but...
a lot more sibling punching, yeah, as I understand.
There you go.
Most of Blur go on to form Gorillaz, or is it just like the one guy?
Yeah, Damon Albarn, the vocalist, he's behind it. Yeah,
brilliant.
But I don't know what the others are doing these days. No idea.
Well, it's been a long time. Neither of us are young anymore, Ross. I feel bad telling you that. But we're old now. My knees hurt. That last week of a tour, the it's not just the voice that's tired. It's the whole kit. Everything. Everything's falling apart.
I try and explain that when I get home. I'm completely useless after a tour for about a week or two. I'm just drained and jet lagged. Mm-hmm. Even if I haven't been flying, you know, it's that kind of
true.
Decompression that happens after
it's a stimulus whiplash. It's like your level of stimulus goes from like 900%, you know, having to be sharp, and especially as a front man, like on you got to be rolling with the crowd every single night. You got to make that work, and then you come home and it's like time to change a nappy, pussy. Like, you know, it's, okay, all right, cool, man. Back to reality, I guess. Here I am.
Man, it's completely crushing. But I mean, I guess that's
I love that this is...
that's something I'm not missing. But yeah,
I don't miss the post-tour blues, but that's right. What I'm living in currently. So yeah, it's just how it is. I find it really funny though that you know, we're basically sitting here whinging about the thing that we want to do the most. The irony of the entire thing is brilliant.
Yeah.
Put me on a bus.
The reality is next week I'm going to have to go into some sort of photography job. And just make a living somehow. Otherwise I'm going to lose my house. You know? So it's tough, man. If I'm not doing tours and shows, I got to fill it with something.
So is that you sort of stepping out of freelance and into like a role
it's still technically freelance, but I've got a contract that takes me up till like December, and I just have to take it because it's,
yeah,
you know, my wife,
yes please,
my wife's been fortunate to be able to work during this pandemic from home, but it's expensive to live in the UK, and one salary just ain't enough, you know. And
that's madness.
And without money coming in necessarily from touring or anything of the sort, it's very difficult, you know, especially when things get split six ways in the band as well. And it's just, you know, what kind of living is that? You know?
But, it's not one. It's not.
So I'm going to be taking the brunt for a while and, see if I can get my solo album out. And then there'll be some time to work on new Haken stuff in the near future, but at the moment it's kind of
whenever that happens,
I can't really get anyone excited about anything yet.
Yeah. No, I feel you. And like we've had trouble like even getting together to do like the guys have done some like guitar playthroughs and stuff, and you know we want to do some live stuff where we'd like in a studio space and doing a live performance kind of thing. We want to do all of this, but it's just even the logistics of getting everyone in the same place is just it's a fucking nightmare. So no ifs and buts. I had a lot of people checking in when everything hit and hearing that the tour was canceled, all that stuff. A lot of people going like, hey man, I hope you're okay, and I hope financially you're doing okay, and that's very nice. But it's funny because I was just watching my mates who are our crew and people that work as crew and techs and things like that, just like getting their livelihoods completely ripped from under them. Because, you know, like I don't live off Caligula source. Like we have other things going on, of course. Mm-hmm. That's sort of where we are. Unfortunately, all of us have been able to kind of maintain some kind of work. But
yeah,
for those guys, I mean, that's their livelihood. It's just gone.
Yeah.
Whole industry just crashed. So definitely. It's funny that people just sort of, they see the surface level of it, you know?
Yeah, it's a very important point to bring up to anyone who ends up if anyone ends up watching this video this far into the conversation, then
people like, sitting there
don't forget the crew
on YouTube, like
wrap it up, guys. You know, it's really nice to do this, man. I mean, that's part of what I'm missing as well. Like doing festivals this year, we would have been doing like quite a few festivals and bumping into like fellow bands and checking in on everyone and getting to know people. I mean, I've bumped into you a couple of times. Not that many. I think.
I think the last time was in Brisbane. In my hometown, when you guys were in town.
I think you caught me ordering vegan hot dogs somewhere in Brisbane.
And I too was ordering a vegan hot dog. Yes, and it was delicious and mildly subpar.
I think every time you've seen me though, you know what it's like. Well, you would know what it's like touring Australia when you just have to go city to city without stopping. And I always feel like I'm a zombie doing those tours. And
it's crazy.
Not really myself at all. So it's a bit weird.
We used to drive tour Australia a lot, like particularly the East Coast. And like those long drives, like I remember there's one leg that we did pretty early on where we drove from Brisbane to Sydney and just stayed the night there. Then drove all the way to Melbourne, played a show, drove back to Sydney, played a show, drove to Brisbane, played a show. And by the end of that, the band's career was over. We all hated each other. There was no future. It was an absolute nightmare. And so we started flying after that, but even that's pretty fucked up because you go into the hotel at 2:30, you're up at 4:30 and off to the airport to fly.
Yeah.
Bajillion miles to get there. Yeah.
You develop these kind of airport personalities. All that kind of queuing up for security checks and stuff. It just makes you a very different person. Well, me at least.
Airport personality, is your airport personality easy to deal with, or are you like me?
I'm usually pretty chill, but like some people in our camp can suddenly, you know, like put on, you know, like 30 years and become grumpy old men. But and I have been known to be one of those as well.
I get hangry. Hangry is my thing on tour. Hangry. I was just like, hey Jim, do you want to eat some fucking food? I think in airports for me, I become increasingly facetious to the point of putting us at risk. Like I am just a giggle machine when I'm tired. It doesn't stop. And no one likes it. No one, not even myself. I don't enjoy doing it. And everyone else in the band is frustrated. And I am the problem. And I've acknowledged that now. So I can start to heal. What am I sitting on? That's fine.
I caught you guys, I caught you guys live for the first time. I was actually photographing your band. I think it must have been 2017.
Was that Southampton?
It was Southampton. Yeah, this is a kind of local town to me.
Weird.
And Prog magazine hired me because I live kind of locally to just pop down and see the show. And obviously, I knew you guys from Bloom Record, but I hadn't really heard much beyond that actually at the time.
I kind of wish that wasn't the first show that you saw.
Well, I was going to say like there was probably about seven people in the audience. But I might be exaggerating.
No, I don't think so. I think that's probably accurate.
But even so, man, you guys commanded that stage. You were very graceful about it, and it was an enjoyable and entertaining show. I was hooked from that show onwards. And,
no, that's very kind. Interestingly, at that show, I don't know if you went backstage. Did you check out backstage at that venue?
No, I've never. In fact, I think that venue's closed now for good. But
I hope so.
But no, I never did. No, never saw.
There's a room back. So you go backstage and there's a sort of the largest kind of band room on the left. And you go down to the next door and you walk into what looks like a rubbish tip until you realize that it's an old squash court that just has junk, mountains of junk just piled onto it.
Oh my God.
It was like walking into a dragon's lair if the dragon didn't know what quality materials were. It was just a piles and piles of shit in this place. And we took a whole bunch of photos and stuff there because it was fantastic. It was phenomenal. And I, you know, terrible venue, completely unsafe, broken glass everywhere, seven people at the show. But that's kind of a sweet memory, actually, now that I think about it. Actually, that's a funny one.
Yeah.
Do you have anything from tour that is, you know, for someone that doesn't tour, like if you're just a regular person, never done a bus tour, don't know what it's like, do you have a memory from tour that is, for anyone else, terrible, but that you really love?
You kind of put me on the spot there.
Oh, yeah, well,
I don't know.
How we play.
I mean, backstage issues are a thing, for for sure. Especially when you're trying to cram 30 people into one room, which is like a corridor, basically, sometimes.
Yes.
Yeah. My pet peeve on tours is on tour buses in particular, can be the cleanliness. I'm a bit of an OCD freak.
Oh, right.
With people standing up and peeing all over the toilet and stuff like that.
Okay.
Sit down and pee, people. Things like that really bother me.
Don't be too proud. No, that's funny. That's funny. What it means is that we should never tour together. I wouldn't tread on your toes, but I am a bit of a disaster of a human being.
I'm a disaster in my own house, but on tour, I'm the clean freak.
Yeah. You carry the cleanliness until you get to your own front door.
That's it.
I have a memory from Vienna in 2015, which is like, we were looking forward to playing there, like, because I'd never been to Europe at all at that stage. So this is my first sort of trip there. It was amazing. And Vienna's got all this music history. We wanted to check it out. And because the venue that we were playing was kind of tiny, it had no like bus parking or anything like that. You couldn't stop the bus to unload. We spent the entire day that we were meant to be doing nerdy touristy shit in Vienna, sitting at like a truck stop in the middle of freaking nowhere with just like concrete and nothing behind it. And our guitarist at the time, Zach, went in and just to grab himself some cigarettes or something, like a dirty beggar. And he found, because we don't do this in Australia, we don't sell beer at like petrol stations, like truck stops and stuff. So he came back like super excited, you know, got a bunch of beers. We sat in the back of the bus and just smashed some beers and just went like, yeah, doesn't this suck? And it's funny because, like, again, that memory sucks. That is a bad time, but I cherish it.
Yes.
It's a special place in my heart.
Yeah, it's definitely a thing in touring Europe, with some of the very tiny streets that your buses cannot park in. And we end up having to do a lot of cross loading, which is obviously having to spend a lot of time getting your hands on and transferring all your
equipment
into smaller trucks and getting and then hopping those over to the venue. And
don't say those words out loud.
It's, people who've toured will know exactly what I'm talking about. But yeah, for people who don't tour, that's they're not fun. Well, like you said, the memories that you tend to remember, you don't want to, but you always remember the bad times, you know. And
I have to say, worst cross load, and again, one of those ones that's like a terrible memory that's awesome, was we're in the middle of a race riot in Bologna in 2015. And like, we went to play the show. This was a weird tour, by the way. There's a lot of bad stuff happening. And I shouldn't joke, because later on we were like three nights out of Paris when the Bataclan massacre happened and like all of that. So it was just all the things that could go wrong with this tour went wrong. But in Bologna, it was like there was this anti-refugee protest, and then all the pro-refugee people coming to meet them. And there's like violence in the streets and stuff. And we were trying to get the bus underneath this bridge to get to this tiny venue, and the bus couldn't actually go around this corner on this tiny Italian street. So but all of us and the guys in the other bands, a band called Shining from Norway and Jack Dalton as well, we picked up this tiny car. We just like lifted this car that was parked in the corner badly off onto the side of the road and just plonked it on the, and we climbed up on top of it and tried to bend the street sign out of the way so the bus could, you know, fit around the corner. We detached the trailer, had to wheel it across under the thing. Meanwhile, the helicopter that's above has looked down and seen a bunch of like hairy degenerates like pushing this unclipped trailer under a bridge full of protests. And naturally they send all the riot police down and they've got their shields and armor and stuff on. None of us speak Italian. And we finally managed to get the things open and check it out. And they were like, all right, fine, go. But yeah, that was that's the worst cross load of all time. That was the hardest one we've ever done.
It's funny, like a lot of people assume that, you know, what we essentially do is a holiday. But most of the time it's really not, you know. It's you see a lot of airports, you see a lot of backstage rooms, there is occasions you get to see some sights, and we can't really knock it, you know.
That's true. It's
a beautiful job that we have for the time being.
That's sad.
You know, we'll things are gonna, you know, be different maybe going forward, but we'll we got to remember the good and bad times, I guess.
Totally. I always put it that it's like, even at its worst, it's awesome. Even when it's impossible and terrible, it's awesome.
Yeah.
But I don't say that to my wife because it's work, right. Babe.
Yeah. There you go. Yeah. Oh, man. So, you know, this has been really cool. Great to hang out with you and kind of speak to you finally, like, without being a zombie on the streets of Brisbane.
I feel like this is a thing, and this is the interesting thing about this whole conversation, is that, like, why are we doing this and not hitting record? You know what I mean? It's like, we should easily have caught up before now, but here we are chatting.
Yeah,
because we're hitting record.
Definitely. And we shall. I think we shall going forward.
I'd like that very much.
And yeah, it's made me think about, you know, the people I'm not speaking to at the moment, and they're just kind of otherwise it's just Facebook. How you doing, dude? And it's a little bit cold, and there's, you know, a lot of people I love and respect in the industry, and I might even do a few more of these, you know, connect with, yeah, even not recording, you know, and just connect with
people. Yeah, totally.
Because it's great to catch up, and all of us have kind of been hit pretty bad, and I think we all just need a perk up, really, don't we?
One way or another, yeah, totally. But what we should all do is we should get into a big, like, Haken Seahorse chat, and all of us should just cram ourselves into a small space and just pretend that we're on a bus.
Yeah.
Just like lie in a little coffin and just chat within our little phones in this dark little spot. That's the miracle. That's what
just,
we should do.
Just don't pee all over the toilet seat and I'll be fine.
I'll do what I goddamn
the virtual please. Toilet seat.
In the privacy of my own virtual toilet seat. Well, I'm gonna stop being an absentee father, and I'm gonna go back to read my daughter a book before she goes to sleep.
That's a beautiful thing, man.
It's been a lovely chat.
Things to cherish in life, and family is one of them. So
I
will leave you to that for sure.
I'd be done without them right now.
Thanks for chatting, dude. It's been fun.
No, yeah, you too, man. I'll chat to you again soon, and good luck with the new material. Send me things. I want to hear things.
Definitely. Have things. For sure.
I'll send you a hat.
I need a hat with corks, please.
Brilliant.
What are they called
again?
Take
care, man. An Akubra.
Akubra, that's it.
An Akubra hat and with fucking corks in. I don't know. I wish there was a name for that. Maybe there is. And I'm not Australian enough to know.
It's on. Cheers, man. Take care.
Take care. All the best.
Ciao.
Bye now.